All right, we've hit the 6 o'clock hour, so I think we're going to go ahead and get started. Hopefully more people will join us as we go along, but I'd like to welcome everyone and thank them for attending. My name is Kate McLeod. I'm with the Holocaust Memorial Museum of San Antonio, and we're very pleased this evening to have Lois Roman from the Memorial Scrolls Trust speaking with us tonight about the scroll that we have in the museum. I don't know if everyone is familiar with the scroll, but it is on display in the museum, and as soon as we're open again, you're welcome to come take a look. You can also find information on the scroll on our website. That's hmmsa.org. Let's see. If at any point in the presentation you have any questions that you want to ask Lois, or me or anyone here, feel free to put that in the Q&A section. You'll find that at the bottom of your screen. So right now I'm going to go ahead and hand it over to Lois, and she will take it from here and tell you all about our great scroll.
Great, thank you. Are you going to let me share my screen as well, Kate?
Yes, please do.
That would be great. Thank you. So bear with me one second. Sharing my screen. Great. Can you see all the slides? Wonderful. Well, thank you all for inviting me to speak to you tonight about the Memorial Scrolls Trust Czech Torah collection and to tell this most unique story about one of the founding artifacts from the San Antonio Holocaust Memorial Museum. In preparing for this talk, I went back to our archives and I actually found the original correspondence between the trust, which is located in London, and the founding person of the Holocaust Memorial named Oscar Ehrenberg. And he had applied in writing, because this was back in 1991 and technology wasn't what it is today. He had written a letter to London explaining that there was a memorial being built in San Antonio, and he thought that it would be a wonderful addition to have one of our Czech Torahs on display in the museum. And so a lot of correspondence went back and forth, and he ended up coming to London and actually selecting the scroll that is in your museum today. We shipped it on over after he got back to the States, and I found a newspaper clipping where he was quoted talking about this new memorial, and he said at the time, "The Holocaust Memorial in San Antonio will be a sign of Jews' faith in humanity and a resource center to teach about the Holocaust and prejudice in general." And I just thought that was a really powerful statement, and I think it holds true today. So MST Scroll 534 is the scroll that's in your museum, and it was written in 1830. In what is today the Czech Republic, or now called Czechia. And that makes this scroll almost 200 years old. Now, it's not just an old Torah scroll, it's a Czech Torah scroll, and it survived the Holocaust. And today I'm going to tell you exactly how that occurred. But first, let's have a little geography lesson. If I can move my slides, that would be helpful. Okay, so here's a chart of the area we know as Bohemia and Moravia. These were the areas right around Prague, even in the Czech Republic today, the country, if you're there and talk to Czech people, they think of the country as Bohemia and Moravia. They were really two very different types of areas with different folk art. They all spoke Czech. But they thought of themselves as slightly different kinds of people. The two lands combined make up what is known as the Czech Republic. And there were Jews in these lands for 1,000 years before World War II. There were about 350 small towns scattered around the landmass where there were Jews. And most of those are depicted by dots on this chart. And I know it's really hard to read. So I put a red arrow pointing to the dot that says Slaney. And you'll see that it's located just north of Prague in sort of the northwest quadrant of the country. Bohemia is on the left or the west, and Moravia is on the right. And I just want you to notice the neighboring countries to the Czech Republic. Germany is on the western border, Poland is on the eastern border, and Austria is on the southern border. So there it is, quite right in the middle of Central Europe. So now let's move to the story of the scrolls. And I'm gonna stay on this slide while I tell you the story so you actually pay attention to what I'm saying. But the significance of the photo here, this is actually a photo of our museum in London. And this is how the scrolls were hidden throughout the war. And so I'm gonna touch on that in a little while. So let's go back to the lands of Bohemia and Moravia. I mentioned that there was 1,000 years of history. There are Jewish records as early as the 10th century, and Jews were alternately invited in and kicked out by the ruling forces of these lands over the hundreds of years. And something very special happened in the middle of the 1800s. The presiding ruling family in the Czech lands passed a law that suddenly allowed Jews to be recognized as citizens and actually to own land. And it was the first time that yellow band or funny hat, and they were allowed to really participate in life. So as you might expect, Jewish life in these lands blossomed in the 1800s. There were Jewish settlements in the cities of Prague and Brno. And over the hundreds of years, Prague had more of a ghetto. But in the 1800s, more money was being made by Jews as they moved into industrialization, they were educated, they started knocking down the ugly areas of the ghetto and building new beautiful buildings, and the Jewish quarter of Prague expanded. And in fact, if anybody has been to Prague, you'll know that this area still exists there, and you can go visit a very large piece of the city with beautiful buildings and landmarks. In the rural towns of the Czech Republic, of which there were many, there were more small towns than there were big cities in this part of Europe, the Jews were quite integrated with the Czech neighbors. So they were living side by side, not in a ghetto. The Jews' children would play with the Czech children next door. The parents would trade in the market. And they were so assimilated, in fact, that the Jews who spoke Yiddish and Hebrew also spoke Czech and spoke German. Many of them spoke Polish even. And they got on with their harmonious time. The Jews were extremely comfortable from the mid-1800s until the Second World War. And they were so comfortable that in Prague, in 1906, the Jews built a Jewish museum. It opened in 1906, and it housed Judaica from hundreds of years as the Jews from the rural lands grew up and congregations, as we know today, merge and get smaller and get bigger. Some of the Judaica was sent to the larger synagogues in Prague and then from there to the museum collection. So let's just think about that for a second. 1906, in a big city of Prague, you have Jews and Czechs and visitors who were passing through the Czech lands from Western Europe to what we consider Eastern Europe, all visiting a Jewish museum in Prague in harmony. Well, all was peaceful until 1938. And as we know from history, unfortunately, the dark clouds came with the rise of Nazi Germany. And originally, the Allied forces tried to appease Hitler's Nazi party in Germany. And the Allied forces got together and said to Hitler, "I know you think that you should have all the German-speaking lands back under your control. I'll tell you what. We'll give you the most western portion of Bohemia, and we'll just give that to you. And then you can expand your borders and everybody will be happy." So in 1938, the Munich Agreement was signed, and the Sudetenland, which is the most western portion of Bohemia, was annexed to Germany. The Germans moved in. The first thing they did was close every Jewish synagogue. They kicked the Jews out of every town. Many Jews ran away. So they either bought their way to another country, or they left for the cities of Prague, and all Jewish life in that sliver of Sudetenland ended. Well, it didn't take but a few months more, and the Nazi Party invaded all of Bohemia and Moravia in 1939 and moved in. Well, all Jewish life stopped at that point, and the Germans immediately kicked out any non-Czech Jews. So there were the Czech lands were a place where people from the east in Poland and Russia may have come to the Czech lands, or Jews from the west in France or Denmark may have come east to go to Prague. Anyone who didn't have a Czech-born passport was sent away, and Jewish life stopped. Synagogues were closed, Jewish schools were closed, and the Jews who could tried to leave and run away to Switzerland or some of the other countries that was still accepting Jews from there. All other Jews left the rural areas and came to the cities, tried to live with family or friends, hoping that this was going to pass and that things would get back to normal at some point. Now, I could dwell on the general history of World War II, but I don't want to. I only want to focus on the scroll's story. And I'm going to frame the story by looking at four miracles that I think happened that it allowed these scrolls to survive. So miracle number one, the Jews from 1939 to 1942 had it bad in the Czech lands, but it wasn't horrible yet. In 1942, however, the Nazi Party was much more organized, and there was a big push to actually erase traces of Jewish life in Central Europe. And so the Nazi Party wanted all Judaica from every rural small town and every city to be sent to Prague to. Now, I mentioned the Jewish Museum. It turns out that the four major curators of the Jewish Museum in Prague were still in Prague in 1942, and they approached the Nazi officials, and we're not quite sure how the conversation went, but we do know that they were allowed to stay and help catalog all of the Judaica coming from the rural areas of Prague. This is really miracle number one. These four Jewish curators and other Jews that were put to work carefully wrote down from outside of Prague. They tagged it with a number, they wrote it down in their book, they carefully wrapped Torah scrolls in bags, and they put them on racks like this so that everybody knew where everything was. They had a card file and a big numbering system. There were so everything from the silver on the Torah scrolls to ark curtains to the light above the ark, the Ner Tamid, to the furniture in shul buildings, even pianos and violins and even chandeliers and other objects from just the Jewish homes that were being erased. All of this came to the Prague Jewish Museum, and it filled 40 warehouses after it was all cataloged. Now, these warehouses were in the central city of Prague. Some of them weren't really warehouses. They were the old synagogue buildings that were packed to the gills with all of this stuff. Well, it wasn't long after that, and the Czech lands were then sent off to the concentration camps, including our four curators. They were first sent to Terezin, and then from there, many of them sent on to Auschwitz and the other killing concentration camps. Well, now we come to miracle number two. The scrolls sat in that warehouse, in those bags with their tags, all through the rest of the war. And you might be surprised to know that not that many bombs fell on Prague directly during the war. That's why if you go to Prague today, it's a beautiful city and has been restored. In fact, I heard this funny story while I was there, that only one bomb fell in Prague during the war, and it was an American bomb. It was dropped by an American plane that got lost on its way to Dresden, and it saw a city, dropped the bomb, and it turned out that it luckily was only in the outskirts, and it didn't destroy any of the buildings that held the Judaica. So there were about 118,000 Jews in Prague just before they were sent off to the concentration camps. And after the war, only a few thousand people returned. But here's our miracle number two. One of the few thousand that did return was one of the curators of the Jewish Museum of Prague. She came back and she knew exactly where the Torah scrolls were and exactly where everything was. By 1948, the communists invaded Prague and took over and said, there's going to be no more organized religion at all. So they had no need for all of this Judaica or even the Jewish Museum that was taking up buildings in central Prague. They wanted to take them over for their offices and for housing for the communist leaders. So the curator went to the Communist Party and said, you know, I'm a curator from the museum. Our stuff is taking up all of this room in your city. Why don't my friends and I help you? We can come tomorrow and we can come with a truck and take all these bags and boxes and move them out of Prague for you. And the communists said, sure, if you want to just move it out of here. We have no use for that stuff. So she carefully moved the scroll hoard from inside Prague to an abandoned synagogue building in the outskirts of Prague named the Mishli Synagogue. Now, this building hadn't been used in 100 years already. It barely had windows. It wasn't heated. It wasn't air conditioned. It was basically in a small town with weeds growing all around it. They put all the scrolls on these wooden racks in that shul building, and there they sat from 1948 until the early 1960s. It's cold in the winters in Prague. It's hot in the summers in Prague. The mice were getting in and out. The roof was leaking. It was just terrible conditions. Here we go with miracle number three. After the Iron Curtain was up, it became more and more of a mystery what was happening in the East. But it was popular for art dealers, especially from the UK, to go to Prague in search of art that artists were creating. And one UK art dealer named Eric Esterick happened to be on a trip to Prague to collect art to bring back to sell to the Londoners and even Americans that were interested in buying, you know, this sort of hidden gem. He was approached by a government official from the Communist Party, wearing a raincoat, kind of the typical spy story. He said, I understand you're an art dealer in the UK. Are you interested in some Judaica? Well, Eric Esterick, who was not himself Jewish, but did have one Jewish grandparent, raised his eyebrows and said, Judaica? Maybe. So he was brought to this Mishli synagogue and the door was opened and he walked in and the right side to the left side, these racks of scrolls. And he thought, wow, if this is real, this is something amazing. So he came back to London and he approached Ralph Yablon, who was one of the founding Jewish members of the Westminster Synagogue in London. And he said, Ralph, you've brought art for me before, but now I have something very unique. He said, I was approached and wanted to know if I wanted to buy Judaica. And I went in the building, I saw, well, if they're real, I'm interested. So they were allowed to send a representative to look at some of the scrolls, a very, very small number, who later said, yes, indeed, these are actual scrolls. I don't know if they're kosher, I don't know what condition they're in, but they are definitely real. So Ralph Yablon agreed to buy the contents of the entire shul for $20,000. That brings us to miracle number four. On a rainy day in 1964, two trucks pulled up to the driveway of the Westminster Synagogue in Knightsbridge, London, where the congregants gathered on a Sunday afternoon to volunteer to help unload the trucks. They were wearing casual clothing, they're chatting, they're having coffee, well, tea, because it's London. And the trucks come and they start carrying out these giant gray bags. Many of the Czech scrolls are some of the largest Torah scrolls that we have in the world. Some are small, but most of them are about 2.5 feet long. These giant gray bags with tags sticking off the bottom. And they start carrying them in and putting them on tables inside the Westminster Synagogue. more and more and more and more. And the congregants couldn't believe the vast number of scrolls. They started crying. They started feeling something really moving them, that they were doing such a mitzvah by unloading these trucks. When they were finished, there were scrolls piled everywhere in the synagogue building. So they unrolled a few, and they found incredible, unbelievable scenes. Some of them had blood dripping on them. Some had bullet holes through them. Many, many were tied in ripped tallit or child's clothing, and many had notes tucked in the folds of the Torah scroll from a scribe or a rabbi or a layperson in the shul in either Hebrew or Czech, saying, "Help us, what's going to become of us? I can't believe this is happening." The congregants were so moved by this, it was incredible. Well, the Westminster Shul decided that really these artifacts didn't belong to Ralph, even though he paid the money. They didn't really belong to the Westminster Synagogue. And they started a trust called the Memorial Scrolls Trust to own the scrolls, to fix them up, and to send them out across the world as memorials to the people that perished, to the Czech Jews that left and never came back. Well, one day, shortly after the scrolls arrived in the synagogue building, the doorbell rang. The Orthodox man, which is unusual for the Westminster Synagogue because that's a progressive or reform shul in London. But there was a woman in the shul who spoke Yiddish and Hebrew. She was also the person who was, you know, named to be in charge of this trust and work with the scrolls. She answers the door. And in Yiddish, this Orthodox man says, "My name is Sofer Brand, and I'm here from Israel looking to make some money. Do you happen to have a scroll I could repair?" She said in Yiddish, "Yes, I have 1,564 scrolls. Do come in." So Sofer Brand, although he was Orthodox, he did work in the Reform Westminster Synagogue for 30 years, repairing 1,564 scrolls to the best of his ability. Most of the scrolls came not kosher and not able to become kosher. He tried to at least fix them so they could be sent out as memorial scrolls, as you have in your museum. Over the years, 1,400 of our scrolls have been sent out all around the world. There are on every continent. We have 1,000 here in the US, but they are in Australia, they're in Canada, they're in Hawaii, they're in Italy and everywhere, Germany and Israel. So it's a huge, huge network. Now, this collection at MST is unique, not just because it's the largest hoard of scrolls that was found together, but that all of these scrolls came from Bohemia and Moravia. So they're all Czech scrolls. Also, I mentioned Torah scrolls, which is very unusual, and Megillah scrolls, which is even more unusual. We have 400 binders, or the sashes that were used to tie the scrolls together. And these Torah binders are extremely unique because the Ashkenazi Jews in Central Europe between the 16th century and World War II had a folk art that they used for Torah binders, where the women of the family would embroider information about the baby boy when he was born, and it would be used to tie the scroll for his bar mitzvah and then later for the Shabbat before his wedding. And they have a lot of genealogical information on them. And we also have some very unique etz chaim, or the wooden rollers that the scroll is bound around. They're usually made of wood. We have one out of gold, which has zodiac symbols on it. As I mentioned, many of the Czech Jews were assimilated, and many of them really loved Kabbalah and zodiac symbols and believe that depending on what month you were born in dictated what kind of a person you were going to be. Sounds a little bit like today in the US, but even back then. Most of our scrolls were written between the 18th and 20th centuries. That was the time when Czech Jewry was exploding in the Czech land, so they needed more Torah scrolls for more Jewish people. But recently, out of the collection we still have in our museum, and you see the picture here, one of the very, very, very old scrolls. And it might have looked like, I can't really point to my screen, but if you look on the second shelf to the right, it just looks like a very old gray, torn, ripped up scroll. We carbon dated one of our scrolls that looks like that to the year 1250, which makes it actually one of the oldest Torah scrolls in existence today. That one is in our museum in London. So now let's go back to scroll 534, which is the one in your museum. This scroll came from the town of Slaney, and this town actually developed just during the 1800s, when Jews were allowed to own land and work, and there were mines nearby and a lot of industrial plants, and the Jews came to this town to work, having a lot of Jews. The town was also on the trade route between Prague and Saxony, so you can imagine how busy this town was. So by 1865, there was a Jewish school in this town, and the cemetery was built in 1881. The town itself is only 9 kilometers away from a much larger town called Kladno, and Kladno had more than 400 Jews by 1900. MST has 8 scrolls from this town. We think most of them are actually directly from the town of Slaney. It could be a few of the scrolls came from the outlying villages. Here's a picture of the actual shul building. We have a colleague at the trust who decided that she would give herself a project, and she went to the Czech lands last year with her husband and a guide, and they went to all the towns and photographed what was left of the Jews of the Czech Republic. Slaney had 81 Jews sent to the concentration camps, and none returned. But this synagogue building still exists. It's been turned into a police station, as you can see on the sign. And it's a very ornate, beautiful 3-story building. What was interesting to her was that when she walked into the police station, to the left, you could see the staircase up to the women's gallery. It's still there. And she was allowed to climb through the building. She went all the way to the tippy top. And on the ceiling of the 3rd floor, it's all still painted in blue with little yellow stars, which would have been the ceiling of the actual shul sanctuary. And it's still there today, 2019. Now, I mentioned that the Czech Jews came back, but the Czech neighbors that knew the Jews were still in the town after the war. And they put up this beautiful memorial of a hand with the names of the concentration camps where the 81 people were sent. And just a few years ago, 2 elementary school teachers in the town and 26 children researched every single one of the 81 Jews of Slaney, and they published a book about what they found with photos, with reminiscences from the older Czechs that still remembered the families of the Jews and the people and how they interacted. And the lower picture here is actually the teacher from the town in Slaney holding the book that the kids published. And I just love this. It was gave me a different feeling about what it was like to be Jewish in the Czech lands versus maybe being Jewish in some of the other European countries. The Czechs and the Jews got along very, very well. Now, you've been seeing these beautiful pictures of present day Czechia, and they were all taken by Sheila Pele. The MST has many ongoing projects. In addition to speaking about scrolls like I am today, and having our museum in London, some of our larger projects are on this slide. So on the left, you see this beautiful synagogue building. Sheila and her friend Julius Muller, who lives in Prague, are publishing a book called Light Beyond the Shadow that they found and the people that they found. And it has stories written by the people about what they remember of their Czech neighbors. It's a fascinating coffee table book. And it will be published next year in 2021. So if you like photography and you like the Czech lands, you should check that out. It'll be available on our website. And then I mentioned the binder collection. Here's a picture of one of our binders. Some of them are extremely ornate. This particular one, I mentioned the zodiac symbols. You can see the Taurus, the ram here. And so there will be a binder exhibition coming around the world probably in 2022, And I hope that you look forward to wanting to visit that. We also have one other very large initiative at the Trust. We go around different geographies and put together scroll gatherings. So I mentioned that there were 1,000 scrolls here in the US, and we know where they all are. And when we have clusters, we ask. And we've had small ones in the past, but in 2019 in New York City, we held a reunion of the Czech scrolls, and 75 scrolls came together for one Tuesday night in February. And they represented reform, conservative, orthodox, museums, libraries, all around the New York area. 800 people gathered to see a scroll procession, to pay their respects to these scrolls. And I love this photograph. This is a photograph of some of the scrolls. You saw the old photograph where they were sitting naked on the wooden racks. Now they're cared for in loving communities, so they're dressed appropriately with mantles on. And if you look at the foreground of the picture, you'll see that some congregations choose to dress their Holocaust Torah with reverence to the past. So we have the blue and white stripes like the Holocaust prisoners or a tallit. But if you look farther down the table, you'll see very bright and colorful mantles covering the scrolls. To me, that tells me that those shuls have embraced this Holocaust Torah for its second life, looking forward, teaching the bar and bat mitzvah kids about the story of the Holocaust, but also how important it is to persevere and that we American Jews survived and Jews all around the world, and that we're looking forward with those scrolls. It was such an incredibly moving experience. I wanted to share just a few minutes of a video that was taken from the scroll gathering. Let me just mute myself. So I just want to leave you with these thoughts. The Torah is what binds all Jews together, whether we're Reform or conservative, Orthodox, whether we sit around a fire playing kumbaya on guitars, everyone reveres the Torah scroll. It's the same Torah scroll with the same letters as it has been for thousands of years, and that doesn't change no matter how you celebrate it. It also happens to be the Old Testament for Christianity. It also happens to be read by Muslims, the followers of Islam, as the five books of Musa, to so much of humanity. I just think it's important to focus on what brings us together more than what drives us apart. Each one of these MST scrolls is a messenger from a community that was lost, but it does not deserve to be forgotten. We thank you for listening to our story. Please visit our website, like us on Facebook, and I'm always looking for volunteers if anybody is interested in helping us. We all are volunteers, from our chairman, Jeffrey Orenstein, to myself and everyone else. So I look forward to taking your questions.
All right. Thank you so much, Lois. I don't see any questions in the Q&A. We had one chat letting us know that locally here in San Antonio, Temple Beth El also has one of your scrolls.
Great. Yes, we have several there.
All right. Did anyone else want to pipe up with a question or a chat from our participants? Give you a couple minutes here. All right, I don't see anybody piping up. There we go. We've got a thank you from Nancy. Okay. Barbara had a question. She said, or referring to you, that you said that the scrolls were not kosher. Does that mean that they can't be used?
Yes. So in order for a Torah scroll to be used during Jewish services and to be put in the Ark, it needs to be kosher. And what that means is that according to a scribe, which is the very well-educated rabbi who actually uses a quill and writes the Torah scrolls, every single letter needs to be legible. The scroll parchment can't be ripped anywhere, and everything needs to be exactly as it was for thousands of years. So the scroll has to be perfect. It can be old, but it has to be perfect. When these scrolls were stored for so many decades in miserable conditions, many of the scrolls deteriorated. And when Sofer Brand tried to fix them, a very, very small percent were able to be used during religious services in Orthodox shuls, and we've sent them to the Orthodox communities. The rest of the scrolls were able to be fixed well enough to sit in an ark of a Reform or conservative shul, not really to be read from officially, but for example, I've heard of congregations that will bring the Holocaust Torah out for the bar mitzvah child to see the Holocaust Torah the day before their bar mitzvah, but then they have to read from a kosher scroll in order to actually do the mitzvah of becoming bar mitzvah. And some of the scrolls were so damaged by fire and ripped and things that they were sent to congregations and museums and things that put them in memorial displays. So you have your scroll out in your museum. I've seen in the lobbies of some large shuls, a very beautiful display of a ripped Torah scroll that had a whole scene behind it of burning buildings and barbed wire, and some artists really went to town on it. So that's what I meant by kosher.
All right. We had another thank you for the wonderful program from Rod. And then Nancy had a question. She wants to know what sort of things your volunteers do.
Well, our volunteers do whatever they like to do. So the biggest job that we have for our volunteers is being a Torah detective. And what do I mean by that? Well, 1,400 scrolls went out around the world in the 1960s and 70s. And if you think back to the world then, everything was paper correspondence. And from London to the US was that crinkly airmail paper. And it took a really long time for things to go back and forth. Unfortunately, it was very hard for the people in London to keep track of what happened to the scrolls in the US over time. And we know now, but even decades ago, that congregations merge and close, and new rabbis come, and new lay leaders of the congregation are elected. And sometimes the story of the Czech scroll didn't pass on from the elder people of the community to the newer people of the community. And when our new chairman took over about 7 or 8 years ago, Jeffrey Ornstein made it his mission to make sure that all the data on our scrolls is correct in our database. We were originally using large loose leaves with paper and pen in very beautiful cursive writing, and that's now all been digitized in our archives. We've fed in every letter and every picture that was sent between the scroll holders and the trust, and we can now search by town or search by community, I can tell you how many squirrels are in Texas and how many squirrels are in San Antonio and where the squirrels are from Slaney and where they, you know, in any other town. So that's what we've been doing. The volunteers have helped us make that happen. And so the volunteers will be given a list of squirrels that we think are at Congregation ABC in Connecticut. And we haven't been able to get in touch with the squirrel holder because the congregation merged and moved, and they'll track it down for us. And we have a very good success rate of finding squirrels. And you know, nobody has a bad heart here. It's just over time, the story gets forgotten. And that's why we're doing many of these Zoom calls to remind everybody about what you have. Sheila is a volunteer. She's a photographer. It was her decision to go to the Czech Republic and photograph the towns. She loved it. She traveled for the better part of last year, and she wrote this book, and that helps us. I was very enchanted with the tour of binders and put together the binder exhibition that will be coming globally in a couple of years. And so that was my contribution, other than also being a trustee. And so really, it's wide open. People bring themselves to the trust, and the trust can just use whatever anybody wants to give us.
Excellent. We had one more question. Sandy wanted to know what happened to the other pieces of Judaica that were stored in addition to the scrolls, particularly like silver items and things like that.
Yes. Much of the silver and gold was taken and siphoned off by the Nazis and melted down and made into other things. But the rest of the objects, the 40 warehouses, well, 39, because one was the tourist scrolls, were in Prague, and they reverted back to the possession of the Jewish Museum of Prague in the 1980s when the wall fell. And in 1989, the Jewish Museum of Prague reopened their doors. And I highly recommend to anyone, once the pandemic is finished, to go visit Prague. You can spend 2 days in the Jewish Museum of Prague. They've set up their displays inside the old synagogue buildings that still stand. There are many of them. And the little streets with the Hebrew clock on the clock tower is all still there. It's an incredibly moving experience. And that's where you'll see many of the other objects that were saved from the Holocaust.
All right, that looks to be the end of the questions. So if you can turn off your screen share, I'll wrap us up here and wish everyone a good night. Let's close this. All right, and bring up my screen. All right. There we go. So, of course, thank you to Lois and the Memorial Scrolls Trust. We really appreciate this. Lois and the Trust donated this presentation to us, and we really appreciate that, particularly in these COVID times, to have something virtual that we can offer our audience. That's really great. We also want to thank the Natalie and Gladys Dalkowitz Charitable Trust, which helped us purchase the technology we needed in order to do these webinars. And of course, our annual donors who keep the museum going from day to day, and our sponsors for the For Hope for Humanity benefit that will be happening on October 27th. If you'd like to donate to either the museum or the Memorial Scrolls Trust, you can do that on both of our websites. So ours is www.hmmsa.org. And as we saw earlier, the Memorial Scrolls Trust is memorialscrollstrust.org. And you can donate on either of those websites. So that's all we had planned for this evening. Thank you for tuning in. We appreciate everyone for tagging along for this great adventure. And we will see you some other day. Thank you so much, and good night.